Well, Darren, let's have a look back at what was a colourful career for you. You played well over 300 games for Aberdeen. You scored nearly 70 goals. As you look back, what are your thoughts?
Just great memories all round. Loved every minute of it. To be a supporter growing up as a kid and then get the chance to go and play for your local hero, local team. Yeah, just incredible. So really lucky and grateful that I got the chance to do it for so long.
Was that always one of your big ambitions then, to play for the club that you supported as a boy?
It was, yeah. I mean, I'm a homegrown boy, so yeah, it was to play for your home town was a huge achievement. And yeah, I was buzzing. I didn't get a chance to go and watch Aberdeen a lot as a kid because I was always playing myself, but yeah, it was always an ambition to go and play for the team.
You obviously became a big fan's favourite, a bit of a cult hero. How does that sit with you?
Yeah, fine. As I say, I scored some important goals over the years. So, and as I say, when I put on the shirt, I did my best every game, tried my hardest every game, and I think that sat well with a lot of people.
You played with some great characters. There were some great characters in that dressing room over the years. Who would some of your favourite characters have been in that dressing room?
Oh, over the years, there's been many. Derek White was, an unbelievable laugh. Great captain, good laugh. Kevin McNaughton, still really good friends with Kev to this day. A lot of the boys I kind of grew up with through the youth team, like Chris Clark, Ryan Essen, Michael Hart, Richard Foster, and even the older boys. I mean, there was Ian Jess, Nigel Pepper, going back, Isham Zero Ali. Again, another one that was taken from us too early, but he was a character as well. So, yeah, just over the years, there was many, many guys that were really good fun to be around and training day in and day out with them. It was always a laugh.
Yeah, Hesham was a special character, wasn't he? A special talent, like you say, and you know, it's not very often you get a player with a number zero.
Not at all. No, yeah, it was a bit different. I mean, but yeah, as a talent, he was incredible. Some of the things he did in training, you took your breath away. And yeah, as I say, it was just it's a shame he was taken from us as soon as he was as well. But yeah, you'll go down in the memory of the fans for a long time as well.
For sure. Who were the jokers in the pack? Who was the biggest joker or the biggest jokers?
I was up there, during my time. Michael Hart, when he got bored, could be there. Kevin Rykovich was another one. But yeah, everyone kind of just took their turn, just to kind of spread it out a bit, but I think when the guys were injured and they weren't training, boredom set in pretty quickly, so you kind of had to be on your toes for anyone who was injured.
Ah, so what sort of stuff did everyone get up to then?
Well, I've seen cars buried in snow when it was snowing, probably completely igloed. I think it was Michael Hart's car that got done, and it was 2 days before he got it thawed out. I don't know if this is, but fish in the water cooler. That was another. Well, I think that was Charlie Mulgrew actually.
And that was at Pittodrie.
Was at Pittodrie. Yeah, we'd swapped the blackcurrant juice for red wine, again in the canteen. cups of water above the door was always a favourite for people coming into the home team dressing room. I think the best one we ever got was Jimmy Collarwood. He was all suited and booted, ready to leave, and he came walking through the door and got absolutely drenched and he was raging, but you had no wheeling, crying in the corner, laughing, banging the ground like in stitches. So that was one of the best ones I've seen. So as I say, yeah, there was just lots of shoes nailed to the ground, boots put in water and froze, and guys' clothes tied and put up onto the flagpoles, and just anything you can kind of think of. So you had to have the eyes in the back of your head a lot of the time.
I heard Mark McGee also fell victim to the water prank. Were you part of that?
No comment. Yeah, I remember it well, to be fair. We were going down to play, I think we were going down to play Celtic midweek, and he got Yeah, we did it in the main corridor, and he walked through, and we were kind of all, yeah, he didn't take it well, put it that way. He wasn't best pleased, but God, pretty much everyone fell foul to that one at some point or another, to the point where, yeah, it was banned at one point, especially in the main corridor, because obviously the office staff used to come down from the offices to go to canteen. So they complained because they were obviously dressed in the work gear. So yeah, it was good time. But you had to, as I say, looking over your shoulder all the time.
Absolutely, watch your back. You scored some very memorable goals from your total of nearly 70 for the club. One that obviously springs to mind is that brilliant header against Dnipro. Tell us about that.
Yeah, it's the one everyone talks about. Whenever I speak to people, it's always, yeah, that goal that they go straight to. And
the million-pound goal, they were calling it.
That's what they say, yeah. Again, I don't know how much it made the club, but that wasn't of a concern to me. It was just to do it and get through into the group stages. And yeah, what an experience it was. From the game, I can't really remember much about it. I mean, I've seen it countless times now, and yeah, I was just in the right place at the right time. Great crossing from Fozzie, and yeah, I was just right place, right time to launch myself and stick it in. But yeah, it's great memories, and what a night, and it led on to so many other great nights.
Was it just a case of just use your instinct? You know the ball's coming across, just throw yourself at it.
Striker, yeah, you've got to be in the middle of the box, so that's where I was. And I mean, yeah, Fozzie put in a perfect cross, and it was there just to be headed in. So as I said, delighted it was me that was on the end of it, and that my name's kind of written into the history of the club.
Another one that obviously springs to mind, another very memorable one, a vital one, was that winning goal at Celtic Park in the Scottish Cup quarterfinal replay 2008. That was just a case of instinct again. You just pounced on it and hit it home, didn't you?
It was, yeah. I mean, obviously we were disappointed not to go through in the first game. I mean, Celtic scored right at the death to take it to the replay, and I think everyone thought, right, game over, we'll go down to Celtic, they'll take us down there and beat us. But no, we put on a strong performance down there. And yeah, the ball kind of got cleared from a corner, I think it was, and then it got flicked back in, and I think Lee Miller turned it around the corner, and I was, again, right place, right time, just to run on and smash it in. And yeah, everyone went wild, and we did well, and we held out, and we got through.
I seem to remember sitting in the media section, but also as an Aberdeen fan, it was like Custer's last stand at one stage, wasn't it? Because Celtic threw everything, including the kitchen sink, at you.
It happens a lot down there. Celtic, they're obviously really strong at home. They use the size of the pitch to their advantage, and I mean, they're talented players at the end of the day. So yeah, it was pretty much back to the wall. But sometimes you've got to do that, and we had the goal, so we were confident in our ability to defend, and we did it.
There was an anticlimax after that, though, wasn't there? I mean, the huge high of putting Celtic out, you must have thought, is our name on the trophy, but we all know what happened against Queen's Park, don't we?
Yeah, it wasn't the best day. We were bitterly disappointed with that one. We should have went through, and I think if we had, we would have went on to win the cup that year. Rangers had played a lot of games. Obviously, they went to the European final that year, so they were dead on their feet at the end of the season, because we beat them at Pataudry at home, the 2-0 game. So I firmly believe if we got through that game, we would have went and beat them in the final, but it wasn't to be.
Yeah, that's just the way football is, isn't it? Another goal, maybe not of the spectacular variety. It was against Kilmarnock. Yeah. Talk us through it.
I can't really. I don't know too much about it. Yeah, the goalie caught. I turned to kind of walk back out the box, get back in position, and the next thing, I felt a bang on my head. And first, I thought the goalkeeper came up and gave us a playful tap just to get out of the way, kind of thing. And the next thing, it was cheering, and turned around, and yeah, the ball was in the net, and I kind of realised what had happened. So celebrated like I'd knew what was going on. that they all count as one, so yeah, I was definitely taking it. Like
that gave you almost international fame, didn't it? Because it was featured on telly on shows like Question of Sport. What happened next?
Yeah, I believe they showed it on there. It was a while ago, but yeah, I believe they showed it on there. So I don't know if they got the answer right or not, but I would need to kind of dig up the YouTube and see if there was any footage of it on there to see if they got it right. But yeah, again, a funny goal, and one that, yeah, people do remember.
Just want to touch finally on your stateside venture. Tell us about that, and tell us about from when you arrived at the airport and there was a cheering crowd there for you.
Yeah, it was a bit surreal. I just came off of an 11-hour flight. I was knackered. I had the kids. I had God knows how much luggage. I'd been standing in customs for 2+ hours. So, yeah, to come through the door was a bit like, I just want to get to the hotel and get my head down, and then was greeted by that. But, yeah, no, it was great. I mean, they were excited to have a kind of team coming to Phoenix for the first time, a first professional team. So, the fans were right behind it, and yeah, no, it was great. I mean, a lot of good memories and some bad ones, but on the whole, really enjoyed my time over there. Kind of wish it had went better than it did, but there was factors behind that led to that not happening.
Yeah, well, an interesting chapter in your life.
Definitely, yeah. I'm glad I did it. I mean, I really did enjoy it. Just the complete change of scenery, the different walk of life, the lifestyle was great. Just to go out and enjoy. Dry life. The heat was something else to experience. Like, I mean, I think the hottest I experienced over there was 52 degrees. So you can imagine trying to train in temperatures like that. But no, as I say, really enjoyed my time there. Kind of just wish things had worked out better than they did. But as I say, there was factors kind of that led to that not happening.
Okay, Darren, thank you very much.
No, gets into the box, chance to cross it in, Mackie! Mackie with the header! What?